Hi, thank you for joining us today. My name is Igor Zuckerman. My co-panelist is Dominic Padruano. And the topic today is college planning for all ages, preparing for tests, applications, and bills. Just a couple of words before we get started, sort of housekeeping stuff. So we'll probably be talking for roughly 45, 50 minutes. We'll leave about 10 minutes for the questions. Feel free to type in your questions into Q&A and we'll try to get to them all. Also from my side, as I am the founder and chief investment officer of Eureka Wealth Solutions, this is a wealth management company. A little disclaimer that my compliance requires is that what we're talking about today is in for informational purposes only. This does not constitute any personalized financial, legal, or tax advice, even though we'll be talking about some of those things, but again, just for informational purposes. And with that, let's get started. All right, so I'll ask my colleague to start and introduce herself. Go ahead.
Sure. Hi, and it's great to be with you today, Igor, and thank you to everyone who's here and perhaps to everybody who will be watching the recording after today, January 30th. So, as Igor mentioned, my name's Dominique Paterano. My students call me Dr. P. I was a high school teacher for about 10 years before starting Crimson Coaching, which is a small company which does academic tutoring, test prep, and college counseling for students worldwide. My company name is Crimson Coaching. You can go to a lot of times people ask me, why did you name your company after a color? As you can see from the color of the mats here, they are crimson, which is the color of Harvard, where I got my undergraduate degree. And what I do is really coach students to achieve their highest potential. You can go to the next bullet. And we developed this event because we really think that there is, we were actually just speaking right before we started recording about how we wish sometimes that families who come to us when their kids are in, say, the 11th or 12th grade, how they could have gotten the information that we wanted to get out to them in, say, 8th or 9th or 10th grade, while there was much more time to kind of take the steps that we're talking about. I mean, it's great to plan even in 11th or 12th grade, but of course, if you can do some of the things that we suggest earlier, you and your family will be in that much better of a position to get into college and to pay for it. And just another sort of like housekeeping thing, we will take questions at the end. And of course, if you have any questions in the meantime, we'll take a look at the chat. I'll try to monitor the chat. And if it's not clear, if it's for Igor or me, I'm assuming if it's about money, the question will be for Igor. If it's about academics, it's going to me. But you could put that in the chat too.
Great. And another point that I forgot to mention is that we are recording this webinar, so recording will be available. Just again, FYI, we are recording. And as for my introduction, so as I mentioned, I'm a co-founder and chief investment and chief executive officer of Eureka Wealth Solutions. My background was originally math from Cornell, and then master's in financial engineering from NYU. I spent about 15 years of my career on Wall Street, some of the biggest investment banks that you probably see here. And I've been running this company for over 10 years now.
So I'll be kind of addressing my remarks and what to do in freshman, sophomore, junior, and senior year. But this first slide are things that I recommend that families can do early, and that it, in fact, before the ninth grade, and they can start doing all 4 years and can continue doing all 4 years of high school. So next bullet. The big thing for both for SAT, ACT, as well as school is to read quality nonfiction. Not that fiction is bad, but in my point of view, generally English teachers do a pretty good job of the fiction landscape, but to be able to read a variety of types of quality nonfiction and be able to identify the main idea. Many of you may have heard that the SAT went digital this year, and in that changeover from paper to digital, the test also changed. And more than ever, the reading and writing component of the SAT is really asking students to be able to identify the main idea. Next bullet. I also recommend from the first day of ninth grade, keeping an extracurricular journal. You don't need to do anything big. You know, it can be a sort of very small book like this. Just write down what you did, perhaps not even on a weekly basis, once a week, maybe on Friday, how long you spent doing that activity that week. Because at the beginning of 12th grade, when you're filling out your Common App, you're actually going to need to tell colleges how many hours per week, weeks per year, and years you did a certain activity. A lot of times I'm really shocked when I'm putting together a college list for families that students have never visited a college campus by their junior or senior year. I think it's a great inexpensive way to figure out the types of campus your child might like by just visiting very nearby different types of schools. So what do I mean by different types? Big school, small school, public school, private school, rural, urban, and all the permutations thereof, so that by the time your child is in 11th grade, if you do want to get on a plane to say, go out to California, you won't be visiting a variety of types. You'll only be, say, visiting those big urban schools like UCLA, if that's what your child knows that he or she likes. Another really underutilized aspect of college admissions is the sort of more socio-emotional part of learning, which is the relationship that students can build with teachers. Of course, if they're experiencing academic difficulty, their first line of defense should be the teacher. Even if they're working with a tutor or somebody like me, I always tell students, go see your teacher, because your teacher's the one giving you a grade and also giving you the assignments. But in addition to that, building up a relationship with a teacher from a young age can help when they have to write a letter of recommendation for you in the college application process. And then finally, really think about who your friends are. There's tons of studies that show that, for example, students whose friends smoke marijuana are much more likely to then go and smoke marijuana themselves. And I know there's a, you know, large brouhaha. I'm not going to get into it for legality purposes for adults, but clearly for the developing teenage brain, smoking marijuana is not a good idea. So choosing friends wisely is a really important thing. And I think the next bullet is about, I will say it's not there, but I will say that watch what you post on social media. College counselors do Google students, and you know, there have been instances where even private texts among students, in one case, was forwarded to the Harvard Office of Admissions. And about 10 years ago, a boy's offer got rescinded from Harvard based on something he said in what he thought was a private text. So that you should do forever. But in ninth grade, it's really important to establish good study skills. And, if your child is struggling with that, the grade that I taught for the longest amount of time when I was a high school classroom teacher was ninth grade. I spent a lot of time doing that. So if your child needs help with that, I can certainly help with that. Next bullet. Interestingly enough, a lot of times people think that the ninth grade grades don't count. Certainly if your child struggled in ninth grade, but then their grades went up, college admissions officers will take the ninth grade grades with a grain of salt, and you won't be penalized too much for that. But in this age of hyper-competitive college admissions, getting great grades in ninth grade right out of the gate is certainly a way to distinguish yourself from your peers. And then, if you want to try something new, now's a great time to do that outside of the classroom. I once had an 11th grader who had been doing competitive gymnastics from 5 years old to 10th grade. And then in 11th grade wanted to try crew in the hopes that that would help distinguish her. Of course it didn't hurt her case, but it didn't really help either because, she didn't have the time to really make her mark in rowing. Whereas if she had done that at the start of ninth grade, it really might have helped her more in that college admissions process. 10th grade is really the time you want to start going deep. And if the grades were uneven in ninth grade, they absolutely must go up in 10th grade. In addition, you might want to think about, the activities that you liked the best in ninth grade. Consider narrowing the scope and doing some more leadership activities in them, maybe, running for an office or something like that. Next two bullets. In terms of academics, you might even want to think when choosing your 10th grade classes, if you didn't take any AP courses in the ninth grade, try to take one that you may really have held some passion for and had some success in ninth grade, consider taking an AP in that subject matter in 10th grade. And then finally, there's a lot going on about test optional. Let me just say, I have a blog piece on this on my website, that test optional does not mean you don't have to take the test. Studies show that students who do submit scores, SAT or ACT scores, get accepted at higher rates at most colleges than those who do not. The only schools, but one of the most prominent example of a school that will not even take your scores is the University of California system. That's called test blind. Most schools, however, right now are test optional, meaning you can submit them and they will be considered. I recommend if your child has taken Algebra 2 in 10th grade, definitely prep for the SAT or ACT in that summer between sophomore and junior year, because there's just less on their intellectual plate, and they can really dedicate themselves to getting a great grade on the August and maybe October tests for the SAT or the September, November for ACT.
Right. So when we talk about paying for college, the first thing we need to know is how much is it actually going to cost before we figure out the ways of doing it. And this little graph is not meant to scare you, but it's meant to show you what's been happening with the college costs in case you haven't been paying attention. So these four lines show you the public four-year versus private four-year and public and private two-year, and how they've grown since the 70s. And this is only through 21, because public data is not available beyond that just yet. But as you can see, it's been growing almost exponentially. And for the public full year, we are in the realm of about $70,000 for tuition and fees and room and board, all in for an average public four-year college. So when you're considering your costs, in addition to tuition and fees, by the way, range all kinds of, from administrative to application to various other fees. They may not be, they may be small by themselves, but they add up. And then room and board. And this is what the statistics is based on. But you should also consider things like books and supplies and transportation. And as a matter of fact, when colleges figure out total costs, they usually include those, although they may vary slightly. So the one big takeaway from here is that college costs increased faster than inflation. And if you've heard what inflation has been doing last couple of years, that should paint you a picture as well. So there are two main sort of buckets, if you will, of how you would pay for college. And the first one is financial aid, in addition to the savings that I will be talking about in a few minutes. So financial aid is actually four different types that you should be aware of. And that includes scholarships, which is merit-based and requires no repayment, which is probably the best way to get it. There are also grants. These also require no repayment, but they're need-based, and that will depend on your family financials, and I'll be talking about that in a few minutes as well. Then there's work study, which is an opportunity for students to earn a part-time job on campus, typically, to cover some of the costs. And then finally, there are loans. That's a big topic. We unfortunately don't have a lot of time today to cover all of them, and I'm sure there's a lot to talk about loans, but loans are also come in different types and shapes. Some can be done by students, some by parents, but with some exceptions that also came recently, they typically would need to be repaid. And what you can see on the right is the chart of roughly where the payment comes from. And over 50% of overall college costs are borne by family income and savings. About 26% is scholarships and grants, and then 18% is borrowing, essentially some forms of loans. So how do you actually get the financial aid? What you need to do is apply for it, and there's a standard application called FAFSA. Hopefully you've heard about it. This is a uniform application. It has to be filed annually for every college year. And it's used by most colleges. There are some exceptions for need-based financial aid, for work study. And also there are some scholarships that actually require you to file that as well. What you need to know about it is that if you've heard about it and you've looked at it before, then a lot of the things you think you know, you sort of need to relearn, because FAFSA has just undergone a major transformation, and I'll be talking about that on the next slide. Literally from this year, from the 24-25, the whole methodology of how this is calculated has changed. So what you also need to know about it, which is questions that we often get from people, is what tax information goes into it? And basically, we're talking about the previous year. So for the 24-25 version of the FAFSA, you will be using the 22 tax information. And obviously for every next school year, you would be looking at using the previous tax information, previous year's tax information. Also, there is no income cutoff. What that means is that you can fill out the FAFSA No matter what your income or assets look like, a lot of people make a mistake of thinking it's too much, and you know, there's no point filling it out. I'll address that in a little bit, but the bottom line is, if there is any chance that you may actually qualify, or there's maybe some scholarships that your child may qualify for that's asking for it, it's still a good idea to fill it out. And as far as the deadlines, so there are three different deadlines for filling out FAFSA. One is at the federal level, which is actually the most generous one. So for the 24-25 school year, you can fill out FAFSA on the federal level up until June 30th of 2025. However, your state will have a deadline most likely before that, and there is a website where you can check your state's deadline. And then your school may have an additional deadline, and that usually comes earlier. So check with your school. A lot of the times it's due shortly after the applications are due, but even though financial aid is blind and they will consider it separately, in order to be in the best position to receive it, make sure that you get it before the school deadline. And now I'll dive in a little bit into the new FAFSA. We've been getting a lot of questions about this lately, and this may be confusing. I will obviously not be able to cover all of it, but I'll give you the highlights. So one of the questions we get is, first of all, what's reported on the FAFSA? What types of things do I need to know about? So some of the things that are reported are student citizenship status. It's important because for the federal aid, there are different considerations, obviously. Then the colleges where student is applying. So all the colleges where you're applying will be listed in there. Then the parents' marital and custodial status. Obviously, single parents and married parents will receive a different consideration. Then there's income information for both parents and the student. And then as far as assets are concerned, what they're looking for is information on checking, savings accounts, investments, and certain other assets for both, again, parent and student. One of the questions we get, probably the most common one, is on any specialized savings plans that I will be talking about in about 15 minutes. Things like 529 plans, are those included? They are. They're included as parent assets, but overall, roughly about 5%, I won't bother you with the exact formula, but roughly about 5% of 529 plan balance will be considered to be part of parent assets. And by the way, not grandparents. So if you have grandparents of the student who have 529 plans, those are not included in the calculations at all. They also do not include things like primary home, retirement accounts, so whether it's IRAs or 401ks, the actual value of them, or life insurance. None of those are included in the FAFSA. However, things like deductible contributions to IRA or self-employed retirement plans, they're actually added back in. So if you contributed on the year that they were looking at, they will add that back in and count that as part of your income. However, that does not concern a corporate 401ks. So that's the new rule in FAFSA. So the corporate 401k contributions are really deductible. And also debt. Any debt you have that is not was somehow attached to the report's assets will not be included. So if you have credit card debt or auto debt or any or your own student loans, those you cannot reduce your numbers using that. And so what the calculations are this year. So first of all, a couple of major points of the changes. If you were familiar with roughly the methodology of how it worked before this year, is that there is, first of all, a lot more aid for single parents, which is good news, especially things like eligibility for maximum Pell Grant. Also, if parents are separated or divorced, before that, the reported income used to be used specifically only from the person, from the parent who resided with the student. Now the guidance will be to use the income from the parent who provides the most financial support. So in most, sometimes it will be the same as before, and sometimes the actual numbers are going to be higher. So keep that in mind. Also, one of the biggest discounts before was the number of siblings in college. Unfortunately, this is no longer applies. So for middle and especially high income families, this is probably the biggest drawback in the new FAFSA. And also, family farms and small businesses that used to be omitted in the FAFSA will now have to be reported as assets. So that's another big drawback for that group of people. Additionally, they also included things like trusts and inheritance. So more emphasis on wealth, with the idea that those groups should be paying more. Obviously, if you fall into those groups, that's a negative. And so the main formula of how the calculations work now, I won't go into all the details, and even those bullets that I have here are probably too much detail. What you need to know is that it's the new methodology that is centered around student aid index, so-called SAI. And that is determined as the total parent contribution plus total student contribution. And the total parent contribution is a formula based on the total parent available income, which is calculated based on the tax information. And then they take 12% of parent assets and some of the assets that I was just talking about before. And then they add those up and they assess it at progressive rates. So very much like taxes, it will go into ranges, and those ranges go from 22% to 47% of that sum. And that becomes the total parent contribution. And then the total student contribution is actually even simpler. It's basically student income. The first $9,410, please don't ask me how they came up with this number, but the first $9,410 are basically not counted. Any income above that for the year, again, as I mentioned, the year before that, the taxable year, will count as at 100% of expected student contribution, and then 20% of student assets. So a lot of students may not have any assets, but if they do have checking, savings account, or some investments, this is where the 20% will be assessed. So then when they add up these numbers, that becomes your student aid index. And then the total cost of college that we talked about 5 minutes ago will be used to subtract this number from to arrive at the number that that is likely your need. And that will be considered by the federal, state, and school resources to figure out a package of financial aid for your student. Dr. P, back to you. You're on mute.
Yes, I realize that. I just wanted to ask, address a couple of things, Igor, that you said, and also let you know there's been a couple of financial questions in the chat that I've kind of weighed in on. But I think obviously, if you want to weigh in as well, I think you're better equipped to answer them. But I will just say, you know, when Igor was talking about scholarships as being grants and scholarships as being 26% of the total way that people pay for college, that, and a lot of times people don't know this, but many times colleges require an SAT or an ACT score before they will even consider a student for a scholarship. So that's also another reason to encourage your child to take the SAT or ACT. And of course, many times students will have to write essays for that. I will also say, and I've heard this, I'm a big proponent of and listener to the Testa and the Rest podcast. It's an excellent podcast that deals not only with standardized testing, but college admissions. And they've had a lot of people from the admissions side talking about, and the financial aid side at colleges, talking about things to do. And one of the things that they have recommended is fill out that FAFSA as early as possible, because sometimes there is a limited pot of funds at a school and it's kind of first come, first serve. So, you know, if you're able to, you know, this year was weird because it was supposed to open up, you know, first December 1st and December 31st, and it just opened up recently. But in most years, that FAFSA, I believe, opens up on October 1st for the next year. So there's, you know, a reason to kind of have all your paperwork together. But on to this part, the academic part. So by 11th grade, we kind of left off with 10th grade going deep, right? 11th grade, you really want to demonstrate that to an even greater degree. So academically, you want to make sure that you're taking two or three of the most challenging courses offered. Now, I want to just mention, because I know some schools allow students to take five AP courses in a year. I have to say, unless those are the really easiest AP courses that there are, and I hate to do this, but for example, AP Environmental Science is known to be a much less rigorous course or difficult course than, say, AP Physics, AP Psychology, much less than, say, AP US History. So unless those are really easy AP courses, I would kind of cap my child at three per year, because the epidemic of mental health issues among this generation is just astounding. And you really want to make sure that your kid is not overtaxing themselves. Next bullet. If you haven't taken the SAT or ACT, you definitely want to finish that up by June of the 11th grade. It is really difficult for students who are writing their college essays over the summer and into the fall of junior year to also have to study for the SAT, because they didn't start until the very end of 11th grade. So make sure, like, now is a great time. If an 11th grader didn't take it in the fall, now is a great time. So you can still get that March, May, and if necessary, June SAT administration, and then be done with it by July. In terms of extracurriculars, you know, a lot of people say, well, is it not good to join things in school? Of course it's good to join organized extracurriculars. But if you really want to stand out among the pack, what you want to do is show initiative outside the classroom. I call these sorts of things impact projects. And again, we don't have time to go into what they are, but if you're interested, you can go on YouTube, search for Crimson Coaching, and find my video on impact projects. But these are student-originated, student-led projects that are either service or research-oriented, and they are a way that many students can distinguish themselves in the admissions process. Next bullet. Now's really the time. This is a great time over February break and April break that you can start visiting some of your safety and target colleges. Everybody loves to start with the REACH schools, but unfortunately, you know, those are REACHs for a reason. Most likely students won't get into their REACHs. You really need to be sure that you're going to be happy at some of the safety and target colleges on your list. And if you don't even have a list yet, now's the time to make that list and try to visit those schools while they're in session. If you can only go in the summer, it's not a bad thing, but you always get a little bit more feel for what that college is like while the students are there. And then finally, once again, take those, you know, lessons you learn as a ninth and 10th grader by popping in and learning how to talk to teachers outside of the classroom, take that even further now and try to do that with two academic teachers from the 11th grade and your guidance counselor, because all three of them will be providing letters of recommendation in the 12th grade. In terms of what those recommendations look like, you know, they are, a lot of times when students come to me in 12th grade, I always say, well, the only thing you have control over by the senior year is your essay, right? But if you're before the 12th grade, you still do have some control over teacher recommendations. Now, of course, you can't tell them what to write, but you can show up for office hours, not just for extra help, but to think about your discipline, maybe how it relates to the outer world. So whether it's, you know, AP Physics, looking at what maybe NASA's doing online on NASA's website, or my discipline is US history, looking and saying, well, how is US history like sort of playing out in the news today, and talking about that with your teacher. Next bullet. You know, it's great if you're a student who's extroverted and you're able to participate in class. You might not need to go see that teacher as often, but for those students who are introverted and hate raising their hand in class, then those teacher visits become even more important, because the teacher needs to have something to say. And if they don't know you outside of class, and you never talk inside class, that letter is going to be kind of mediocre. Students often will, and I've been asked to write hundreds of letters during my career, and I wrote most of them, but one time I did have to tell a student, you know, honey, I think you should ask somebody else, because I knew that I couldn't write her a strong letter. I'm a person who doesn't shy away from conflict, but not every teacher is going to tell that to a student unprovoked. So they might just write you a mediocre letter and you'll never know it, because you have to waive your right to see that letter. So ask the teacher, will you write me a strong letter? And if they say no, yes, you know, it's not fun to hear that, but it's better that you hear that in May or June than you get not accepted to your dream school because that letter was lukewarm. And then finally, I recommend asking your teacher in May, because the summer is a time when many teachers will sort of catch up on things they let go during the spring and get a head start for the fall. I knew I was that kind of teacher. And the fall is a very busy time for teachers when they come back to school. Sometimes schools will put caps on the number of letters that they'll let junior teachers write, because some teachers get asked, you know, popular teachers might get asked to write 50 or 100 letters, and, you know, teachers don't get compensated extra for that time and effort. So if you get in and say they're only allowed to write 25 letters, if you're one of the first 25, then that's good for you.
Right. So now that we're done with financial aid, let's talk about the savings portion of the equation. So what you see here is a couple of charts that actually tell you the story. Let me give you the biggest secret right away. You can obviously save for college any way you want. You can put money into checking or savings account. You can put money in a piggy bank or investments or under the mattress. The trick to save for college is to be able to use various tax advantages to save for college at the same time as you're saving on taxes. So what you see on the left is that about 30% of total savings that Americans have done for college are through 529 plan. And if you're familiar with it, great. If you're not, don't worry. I'll cover it in a little more detail in the next slide. The other options are Coverdale ESA, that most people are not familiar with. That's about 2%. There's prepaid state plan, which is about 8%, which is also a version of 529 plan. Everything else here, the other 60%, is what you should not be doing, that the Americans are doing. And this is why we're doing this webinar, this, or at least from my perspective, this is a lot of the times why I have a job. So you benefit from it and you don't do what 60% of Americans are doing. And as you can see on the right side, this is just a rough estimate for you of what the rest of the country is doing in preparation for college. Again, 529 plan is ahead, but there's other ways that people are doing, and not that they're completely wrong, but there are better ways of doing it. So what are the considerations? Well, first of all, you have to look at benefits and disadvantages for each one of the type of vehicle that you would be looking at. And some of them are, like I said, federal income tax treatment, and that applies to contributions to any kind of plan, growth in it, whether it's taxed or not, and then distributions, again, taxable treatment. The state income tax treatment sometimes is similar to federal, but in a lot of cases it's different and it varies state by state. Then also you have to remember about the gift tax treatment. What that is that when you give money to somebody else, including your children, even through any of these accounts, you may be subject to the gift tax, which basically says anything above $34,000 a year as of now for parents filing married to married filing jointly to their kids would be considered a gift and would be subject to a gift tax treatment. So something also to remember. Then there is a state tax treatment, which comes in some unfortunate cases. Then you have to consider maximum investments, annual and overall. Sometimes it doesn't exist. Sometimes it's high, sometimes it's low. Then also the ability to change beneficiary. If you have multiple kids, and one of them decides not to go to college, can you change the designation? Then also things like all kinds of restrictions on the time, age, income. And then, of course, you have to consider the federal financial aid treatment. I mentioned that briefly on 529 plans. And then investment choices. What can you invest in within those plans? And then when you take the money out, what is considered qualified expenses? And what happens to those that are non-qualified? What can you do with that? So these are all the different considerations. And these are all the different vehicles to consider. We obviously don't have time to go through all of them. Some of them have different features. You can use any combination of them. They're not mutually exclusive. I will only be talking about 529 plan for a little bit, but I can tell you we have a giant matrix, we call it, of college savings options available for the asking. If you want to ask, it's literally a giant table with columns on the right and the rows on the left that explain what are the benefits and disadvantages of each plan and where to look for more information. So if you're interested, let me know. I'll be happy to share that with you separately. So the 529 plan, which is not a cure-all, but it's usually one of the best ways to go. It involves a big federal income tax benefit, which is your investments in that plan grow on a tax-deferred basis, and also the distributions, once you take the money out and use them for college, they're tax-free. So, in addition to that, well, you obviously have to use your funds for education. In fact, student loan repayments may qualify as well. And in many cases, in many states, private school K-12 tuition qualifies. Before you ask, New York is one of the states that does not allow that, but some other states do. There's also high contribution limits. Depends on the state, again. In some states, it's as much as $529,000 total per account that you can do. And they typically don't charge a lot of maintenance fees, which some investments do. Favorable financial aid treatment, as I mentioned. State tax benefits may also exist. Let me give you an example. In the state of New York, for parents filing jointly, up to $10,000 of their contributions to 529 plans combined across multiple potential accounts are deductible from your New York State income tax, regardless of your income. So let me repeat that. Up to $10,000 for a couple, you can deduct off your New York State taxes every year. That's not the case in all other states. Obviously, states that don't have state tax, you will not get that benefit. New Jersey does not give you that benefit, for example. Something like Massachusetts gives you $2,000 instead of $10,000. So, but if you're in New York, it's one of the best benefits that you get in addition to all the other things I just mentioned. And then one of the newest things, the legislation that just passed a year ago, tells you that if you have money at the end of the plan, first of all, you can change your beneficiary. But if you don't have another beneficiary, you get a chance up to $35,000 as a one-time rollover to a student IRA. So if you overshot and you still have money left, or you ended up going to a cheaper school than you thought, another $35,000 you can contribute to an IRA. The only drawback potentially is that there are no self-directed investments. In other words, you have to choose from a list of investments that are provided to you. You can't put your own. To you.
I'm just going to ask you, Igor, if you want to check out my question to you in the chat before we start.
Yeah, you can go ahead. Just go through it, and we'll take 5 minutes, I guess, for the
sure. The so, questions. We wanted to have this done by 1 o'clock. So if you don't mind, just put all the bullets up and I'll just talk about the most important things. I think, you know, I've kind of covered all this already. So you can go to the next slide.
Okay.
I think it's really important for students' mental health, for parents to constantly tell students that college is really what you put into it. There really are studies that show that students who go even to community colleges, as long as they find great mentors, which could even be older students than them, and get involved in the life of the college, such as, you know, clubs and sports, they get more out of their experience than, for instance, students from my alma mater, Harvard, who never got involved and never had mentors. So that's really important, because I think, you know, the TikTokization of college admissions, where students are like getting their Ivy League college admissions, students think that they need to have that too. And that's not necessarily the case. You can go towards the rest. I would just say, you know, watch that senior slump. It is real, and college admissions have been rescinded for failing grades in the senior spring. You can go on to the next one.
All right. So one other quick thing I wanted to mention before we go is that a lot of the times people whose kids are juniors or even seniors, and they just start on how am I actually going to pay for college? The solution that we also provide through my practice, using a third party fintech called Collegiate Funding Solutions, what they do is provide a number of tools for you to manage this process. Basically, they would ask you to put in some basic high-level information on your student, SAT scores, your averages, and schools you apply to, as well as some basic financial information from the student and from the parents. And what they will do is give you the costs for your target schools. So unfortunately, there is a even though there is an estimator on the federal website, it's still using the old methodology, and it hasn't been very good to begin with. So you would at least know what your financial aid you're likely going to get. It will also tell you things like scholarships for the schools you're applying to. These are the scholarships that are available. It will even look at your SAT scores and other information, your background and where you're from, to see which ones you're likely to get or the ones that you should be applying for in priority. It will also give you things like strategies to increase financial aid. We haven't talked about it much, but one of them in the new FAFSA, for example, is that if you are contributing to an IRA and you have an option of contributing to 401k instead, that's a better option because that's the one that will actually reduce your income for financial aid. The IRA contribution gets added back in. And there are others as well, depending on the information that you put in. So these are some of the college savings and funding strategies that we're talking about. And it will also give you a report of similar programs that your student is looking to apply to, with costs and with also things like percentage of graduates or starting salaries after those schools, which is a great way for you to compare information. And it also goes back to one of the questions we had about a potential business case of going to a specific school, mid-level, maybe private school versus public school. Obviously, and as you're looking at some of these reports, and by the way, this is just one page from multi-page reports that we would provide to you that we found very useful. So if obviously you have to make that decision with your student together, what school is right for you, there is no silver bullet in that. Obviously, the cost is going to be significantly lower if you go to a private school, especially CUNY, but SUNY as well is substantially lower, for example, than private schools. So the question is, what are you getting out of it as a business case? And yes, there's connections, there's the name of the school that may be recognized by employers and peers as well, but it's also the program of study. Depending on the major, depending on what your student is looking to do, some private schools, even though they're middle tier, may have certain programs that are in demand that will make it a better business case for you versus some other programs that maybe are mediocre and where it does not make sense. But this is something you have to do a lot of research on. Hopefully the reports I'm talking about can help, but ultimately this is a decision for parents and students. So one last thing I wanted to mention about my company. So we are, as I mentioned, a wealth manager, and we do all the normal things that wealth managers do, including managing investments and doing financial planning for people. But specifically, when it comes to colleges, I already talked about some of the things we do. One quick thing I wanted to point your attention to is that things like 529 plans that you normally have to set up and manage on your own, and most advisors are unable to do because you can move those into advisor accounts. We can, again, with the help of technology, we're able to manage them for you if you'd like us to. And I can go into that if you want to contact me later. I'll explain exactly how that works. It's also on our college planning page. You see the website under here, and you can see our college planning page from the menu there. So that's pretty much it for me. Back to you again.
You could put all of them on the screen at once.
Yeah, sure.
So I have a little, like if we were in person, I'd give you a little handout because I'm a high school teacher at heart, but you can email me for a PDF of that. I'm on Facebook, but I have to admit, not as much as I would like. The best way to kind of keep in touch with what I am doing when is I give lots of free talks, both here on Long Island, where I'm located in person, as well as online for libraries throughout Westchester, Rockland, and New York City. If you sign up at crimsoncoaching.com/newsletter, or if you go to the homepage, there's a black banner that says sign up for Dr. P's newsletter, and you click that, you'll get a free newsletter that has like a little article about the college admissions process every month, as well as way down at the bottom, a list of all my free talks. And then of course I do have a lot of them already pre-recorded on youtube.com. You just go to youtube.com/crimsoncoaching and you'll get me, not the Alabama football team, which I think they're not very happy about.
Sounds good. So that's what we had for today. This is our information. Again, let me try to address some of the questions that haven't been addressed yet. Sue is asking about 529 account if your kid is in ninth grade right now. So with Savings for College, we recommend starting as early as possible. We have some clients who start literally opening those accounts in the first year of the new baby. You can turn back time, but the fact is, it's never too late. As a matter of fact, people don't even understand that they can open that account as the student is already in college, and there's going to be 3 years of hopefully growth tax-free within that account, and they can still use it later on. But you can certainly start in ninth grade. It's still a better option than just keeping it in ordinary investment account or any other non-tax-advantaged accounts. And also, again, 529 plans are very good to be used by others. So there's no limitation. Anybody can open a 529 plan for anybody else. So if you have grandparents who would like to help, ask them to open one too. Instead of giving cash as a gift.
I opened one for my 14-month-old niece.
There you go. Yes, you can even do it for, you know, your godson or goddaughter, or you can do it for cousins, nephews, nieces, or even for friends and family. If this is, instead of doing a cash gift for a birthday, consider putting money into a college account. It will go much better. It will go much further than the cash gift you give them now. So definitely consider doing that. Also, as far as scholarships, so I mentioned that we have a solution that does this report. Unfortunately, that part is pretty much all based on schools that you're applying to. There are a number of different websites. We're not specialists in that. I will not tell you I'm an expert in that. There's a number of them out there. Maybe Dr. P, you know some. I know there are some people who specialize in scholarships only. They look for specific scholarships. We're not one of them, but like I said, based on schools, there's definitely a number of scholarships that we can get based on what you're applying to. So the business case, I think I've addressed that of private versus public. CUNY, again, so the process basically for all schools in terms of financial aid is the same. It's FAFSA first, and then anything additional potentially. There is another protocol that some of the schools use in addition to FAFSA. It's rare. FAFSA is usually the first step. There are some schools in New York, for example, a law has been passed that two-year community colleges are completely free. So obviously, if that's the case, you don't need to worry about FAFSA. But just about all the other schools, you have to go through the same process.
I will just mention, by the way, one little factoid that I learned from Ron Lieber's book, and I put that book title in the chat, is that, you know, lots of families totally understandably look at two-year colleges as a cost-saving method of getting a four-year degree. But unless, you know, you're really sure that those credits will be taken at the four-year college, it often winds up turning into a six-year degree, paying for those first 2 years, but then having to take many of those credits over again at the four-year school. So you want to really, again, it's too long for me to go into here, but if your child is thinking about a two-year school, because obviously there are many in CUNY, you really want to make sure that, especially if you are paying tuition, that they're really careful in the way that they sign up for classes so that they don't have to do the courses twice and you don't have to pay for the credits twice.
Dominic, you may want to repost it. I think you only sent it to me. So make sure you repost it to everybody.
Which one?
About the book, the last.
I'm so sorry. Okay. I will go and put them in the chat again. Yeah. Oh no, it's to. Oh, host and panelist. I see.
Yeah, I know.
Everybody.
It's technology. The more options you get, the more confused.
I know. Oh, I don't have the option to send it to everybody, actually. So I'll just verbally say it. It's, and I spelt his name wrong anyway. It's Ron Lieber, Leiber. And his book is called The Price You Pay for College. That's excellent, both from an admission standpoint and a financial standpoint. And his colleague at the New York Times, Jeff Selingo, Selingo, published the year before, Who Gets In and Why? A Year Inside College Admissions, which, you know, now is 4 years on, you know, a lot of people will think is dated. I think its general precepts still apply, but if you want Selingo's insights, the most recent ones, I would sign up for Selingo's newsletter called Next. And you can just go to jeffselingo.com. And for instance, his most recent newsletter gave you an update on the three students that he profiled in that book. All of them are now either out of college or dropped out of college. So it's really interesting, the students he picked, and to hear about what they're doing now.
Great. Yep. I retyped them in general chat. So I know we're over time. Any last minute questions, anybody else, before we adjourn? All right. Well, if you do think of anything, feel free to contact either one of us with those questions. Again, thank you for staying with us today. We'll make the recording available probably within the next 24 hours. Again, any questions, any ideas that you want to run by us, feel free. Thank you for your attention.